So in most of our discussion so far, we have focused on just the processor part of things, right? We've just focused on how instructions are fetched, they're executed. We focused on the number crunching part of it. But anyone that understands even a little bit about computers knows that there is the processing part, and then there is the data storage part, right? So there's the processor, and then there is the memory as well. Okay, and until now, you know, I have introduced terms like instruction memory, data memory. I've even mentioned the word caches a few times in my videos. Now let's formally define a cache and let's understand how that cache is implemented. Okay, so as I said, here's my core, which has, you know, many pipeline stages such as instruction fetch and decode, register rename, reorder buffer, and issue queue, and so on. And I'd mentioned that, you know, in the initial part during instruction fetch, you have to access instruction memory. And then when you're doing loads and stores, you're exchanging values between the register file and the data memory. Okay, so when I say instruction memory and data memory, I'm referring to a really large portion of memory. This is also called main memory. And so instruction memory is referring to instructions which are placed in this main memory, and data memory is referring to the data elements within this main memory. Okay, and this main memory is really large, right? It is usually, you know, 4 gigabytes or 8 gigabytes in modern desktops and laptops. So if you assume this is, say, 4 gigabytes, this is a large enough memory capacity that it has to be saved on several memory chips, and, you know, these memory chips are residing somewhere on your motherboard. Okay, and to get any data from there, it takes many cycles to fetch something. Okay, so it takes of the order of about 300 cycles in a modern, you know, high-performance 3 gigahertz core. Okay, so every time I need to fetch an instruction, or every time I want to do a load or a store, it is really onerous to have to invest 300 cycles to do that from the main memory. Okay, so instead what is done is a small portion of this really large main memory is saved on the processor chip, and this is where the caches come in. Okay, so the caches are implemented as this multi-level hierarchy that I'm showing in this figure. Okay, so the first thing you do is you look up your L1 cache. Okay, so the L1 cache is a small, let's say, 32 kilobyte structure. Okay, and, you know, since it is so small, it can be accessed within one cycle or, say, two cycles. Okay, so I'll assume a one cycle access time. So every time I want to do an instruction fetch, I invest one cycle to get that data from the L1 cache. Every time I'm doing a load or a store, I again invest one cycle in looking up this L1 cache and either getting data or writing data over there. Okay, now since this is only 32 kilobytes of the entire 4 gigabyte memory space, obviously not all the data is going to be found there, right? If I'm lucky, a lot of the time I will find the data that I'm looking for, and there'll be a bunch of occasions where I don't find my data. Okay, usually programs exhibit locality. Okay, and this is called spatial locality and temporal locality. So there are two forms of locality. Temporal locality refers to the fact that if I just fetched block X at time T, then at time, you know, T plus I, I'll call it, you know, after a few more cycles, I'm again likely to access the same block X. Okay, so temporal locality refers to the fact that over time the same block gets repeatedly accessed. Spatial locality refers to the fact that if I access block X at time T, then, you know, sometime later I'm likely to access the very next block, block X plus 1. Okay, or maybe, you know, block X plus 2, X plus 4, and so on. Okay, so what it means is that over time I tend to sequentially move through different blocks of data. Okay, and thanks to these two properties, these caches end up being pretty effective, right? So even though there's 4 gigabytes of memory, my access patterns are fairly regular and predictable. Okay, if I bring something in, I tend to use it a lot before I finally move on to other pieces of data. Okay, so because of that, the L1 cache has a pretty good hit rate. Okay, so out of 100 accesses to this L1 cache, 95 of them end up being hits. Okay, and one other expression that is used is MPKI. That is the misses per kilo instructions. So if I issue 1,000 instructions, how many of them will result in cache misses? Okay, so you know, a 95% hit rate will result in a very small MPKI number. Okay, So, you know, next, if I'm lucky and I get data in one cycle, you know, the pipeline moves on without any stalls. If I'm unlucky, then I have a miss in my L1 cache, and so then I go ahead and look up my L2 cache. Okay, the L2 cache obviously has to be made a little bit bigger, otherwise it's going to contain, you know, no more data than what is already found in L1. So the L2 cache may have a capacity of, say, 256 kilobytes. Okay, and you know, because it is a larger structure, it takes longer to transmit signals across long wires across the structure, and so accessing the L2 cache may take of the order of, say, 10 cycles. Okay, and because it is this larger capacity system, it is going to respond with many of the required blocks, and only a few of them end up being misses in L2. Okay, so let me go back to this MPKI term over here. Okay, so if I issue 1,000 instructions, out of those, you know, let's assume that 40% of them are loads or stores. Okay, so out of these, 400 are loads or stores. And out of all of these loads and stores, only 5% of them are misses. Okay, so that means 20 of those accesses will be a miss in the L1. Okay, so the MPKI in this case is 20. All right, so the L2 is going to receive 20 requests every 1,000 instructions. And out of those, it might correctly respond with 10 of them, and 10 of those might be misses. Okay, so this results in an MPKI of 10. So for every 1,000 instructions executed on the processor, 10 of them end up being misses in the L2. Okay, and so the hit rate of the L2 itself is only 50%, right? It got 20 requests, 10 of them were serviced correctly, and 10 of them did not provide data because you couldn't find it in L2. Okay, so it has a much lower hit rate because the L1 cache filters out a lot of the temporal and spatial locality. Right, so if you didn't find data in the L1, it means that this is data that you haven't touched recently. Okay, so already some of the locality has kind of disappeared. So by the time you look it up in L2, the probability of finding the data there is somewhat small, okay, or at least smaller. So 50% of the time, your lookup in L2 yields a hit, and the rest of the time, it's a miss. Okay, but you'll see that, you know, the L2 is doing a better job of filtering requests. Right, the L1 makes sure that out of 1,000 instructions executed on the processor, only 20 of them escape the L1. And now, again, out of those 1,000 instructions executed by the processor, only 10 of them are escaping your L2. Okay, then you get to the L3. If you miss the L2, then you look up the L3, which is going to be much larger in size. You know, let's say this is 2 megabytes in size. And because of that larger size, this could take, say, 30 cycles to look up. Okay, and now out of the 10 requests that show up at the L3, again, you know, maybe 5 of them are serviced and 5 of them are misses. So the L3 is going to filter out even more of the accesses, and only 5 of the accesses escape the L3 and finally have to go to off-chip memory, which I said, you know, which is the 300 cycle access. Okay, so this is how the hierarchy is organized, and this is done to, you know, to make sure that in the common case, you can get most of your data at very low latency, and then when you have a miss, then you start going to these bigger and longer latency structures, and each level increases your chances of finding the data, but you're always paying an increasing price to look up those structures. Okay, some other points I should mention is this notion of inclusive versus non-inclusive or exclusive. So an inclusive hierarchy refers to the fact that everything in the L1 can also be found in L2. Okay, so out of the 256 kilobytes in L2, 32 kilobytes is basically a duplicate of the data in L1. Okay, so an inclusive hierarchy will reduce your miss rate because the effective capacity of the L2 is lowered. Right, only out of this 256 kilobytes of data, only 224 kilobytes is really new stuff not already looked up in the L1. Okay, but it makes the design of cache coherence protocols easier, and we'll discuss these cache coherence protocols in a later video. Then this L1 L2 hierarchy could also be exclusive to make sure that data is found only in L1 or L2 but not in both. Okay, and this increases the effective capacity of L2, but it makes the cache coherence protocol a little bit more complex. Okay, and between these two is what is called a non-inclusive hierarchy, where there really are no guarantees. Okay, so if data is found in L1, there is no guarantee that you're going to have a copy of data in L2 as well. Okay, so it's somewhere between these two extremes. Okay, so having talked about an L1, L2, and L3, you know, let me clear out the screen a little bit. So now let me talk about how multiple cores will access the L1, L2, and L3, and so on. Okay, so as I said, there are many cores sitting in your processor. This is a multi-core processor. I had also mentioned that, you know, each core has an L1, but it's really an L1 data cache and a separate L1 instruction cache, right? Because every single cycle, you could be fetching the next instruction, as well as doing data access for some instructions already in the pipeline. Okay, so to make sure that you have sufficient ports to do both of these, you know, this L1 cache is usually broken up into two different banks. One is called the data cache, and one is called the instruction cache. Okay, now, you know, these L1 caches are usually private to every single core. Okay, so every core is going to have its own L1 data and its own L1 instruction cache and so on. And then the L2 could be private or shared. So it's possible that, you know, if you assume private L2, then, you know, core number 1 has its own private L2 cache. And then likewise, you could have another private L2 cache for core 2 and so on. Okay, and then maybe your L3 could be shared. Okay, so if you miss in your L2, then everybody comes and looks up the same common L3. Okay, and by having a shared L3, you are perhaps increasing the utilization of that cache. Okay, because every core will have non-uniform demands for cache capacity, and so having a shared L3 finally helps out. But then, you know, keeping these structures private for a while, make sure that, you know, one core does not interfere with some other core's working set. Okay, we'll talk much more later about private and shared caches. Okay, so now that we've understood the general hierarchy within a processor, I shall now take an individual cache and I shall show you how that cache is accessed and how it is organized.